gentlemen, and welcome to Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. Worlds Apart is a program that looks to investigate how racism, ethnocentrism, cultural, and social divide manifest themselves within our society. Worlds Apart will consider the historic, scientific, cultural, and social factors that perpetuate these issues. Additionally, Worlds Apart was created to serve as a constructive dialogue piece around issues of race and now the term ethnicity, that in some ways is an evolution of the term race. At times we get into discussions on this program about what is race from a biological versus a social construct, and the program has tried to in some ways stay current around issues that would provide people in I think more ways effective means of communicating about what are you talking about when you say race versus the term ethnicity. And today we're favored to be conducting a two-part series where I have a group that has in some ways specialized, although there are other groups that has specialized in this whole issue of helping people delineate more carefully and strategically within the corporate workforce, and they may not even be limited to that, but that's in other right. kinds of venues too, the issue of multiculturalism. And I'm privileged to have from Washington, D.C., Ms. Gwen Kreider. Welcome to Worlds Apart.
Thank you very much, Brian.
Yes, give us some background about yourself and what you do.
I am executive director with the National Multicultural Institute and have been there for about a year. Before that, I was in a completely unrelated world.
Yeah, because I was going to ask you about that, because when I came to Washington to meet you to prepare for the program, you had told me about you came out of the, I guess, the art or museum kind of world, and I'm saying, well, help me understand the relationship or how you were able to make that retrofit into what you're doing now.
I've been working in the museum world for about 12 or 15 years, number of years at that time, and one of the things that became very clear is cultural institutions and general arts organizations have a real challenge in attracting diverse audiences, in attracting and retaining diverse staffs and diverse board members.
Right.
So I'd been working essentially as a volunteer on different boards in the museum field or committees designed to address the issue of diversity and inclusivity within arts organizations.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Well, like I said, you're with the National Multicultural Institute, and for some reason, I don't know how, I got one of the brochures probably, I'd say, a year or two ago, and I tried to call, and for some reason, I just wasn't able to connect with the persons that I needed to, so I just let it go, and as would have it, as I say sometimes, God has his own timing about when people connect and how they connect, so I was able to, you know, get in contact with you, so I wanted to come down to talk more substantively with you to prepare for the program about this the organization and to what extent are you having impact? What do you do? How do you do it? And what do you see on the landscape with respect to this whole issue of, you could say, diversity? Because that's something I probably talk with you about too, because to me, as I've looked at that term, and it's probably been just within the last, would you say 15 or 20 years, this term diversity? Although in my research, I'm finding out that that term really goes back a couple hundred years and some research from 1705 about some of these laws that were passed, and I don't want to get into that now, but when I bring, hopefully when I bring in Dr. Claude Anderson, we're going to go into more detail about that. But diversity as we know in a contemporary sense, last 20 years?
Probably longer than that, I would say.
Okay.
I would say longer.
Because I haven't heard much of it, and maybe you have, but I'm only familiar with it over the last 20, 25 years. But it seems, I can say this clearly, that when you look at the sort of chronology of civil rights, generally, I think of terms of really trying to redress, to the extent that America has tried to do that, inequities that have impacted disproportionately people of color.
Mm-hmm.
Would you agree with that statement?
Yeah, I would agree with that statement.
And then that has, the paradigm or the model has expanded, I guess, to affect Latinos, aged populations, handicapped populations. Now the, as they say politically, the GLBT movement, which is gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgendered. How do you fit, or how does America in some ways try to go about addressing, I guess, equitably all these different groups? Can we do that successfully from your standpoint? And then we'll get into more about your organization.
I think the question you asked is not a simple question, obviously. So can America address it? The answer is, to the extent America is willing to address its real issues. I think that what's happened, you talk about diversity as a new term. The reality is, you know, for many people, for many years, when you heard the term diversity, what you really thought about was race. You know, so it became a code name for race. Diversity has always been more than that. It's always been race, ethnicity, physical abilities. We all have differences. And so the term diversity is really intended to reflect the multidimensional nature of people and societies. The whole issue of America treating its peoples equitably, again, I think is a real challenge, and we haven't arrived yet. We still have a very long way to go.
400 years, and we're still saying
we
haven't arrived.
We still have a very long way to go, but I think it's a battle that continues to be worth fighting.
I agree, or I probably wouldn't be doing this program to the extent, but I know some people, and it seems like as the economic indicators tend to be worsening, in my opinion, not only from a domestic perspective, but globally, people seem like they have maybe less hope about, will we ever be able to create some higher level of equity. You know, we might better solve some of the misinformation around race, such as what I try to do on this program in terms of some of the myths and stereotypes that I think were just part of the catalyst that have fueled the segregation in our society. Do you think in some ways corporate America has done a better job as far as some of the softer issues, although they're real, but some of the misinformation like intelligence and race, has corporate America done a better job of addressing?
I think they're beginning to. I mean, in terms of as a segment of society, they do, I think, and have begun to do a better job than society as a whole. And I think part of the reason for that, again, is an economic reality. You know, companies tend to be very good about looking long term and seeing what's on the horizon. For them, it was as much driven by an economic reality, a workforce reality, a customer reality, than it was the right thing to do. And so until we all begin to recognize that there are some realities beyond just the right thing to do.
Business imperatives, I believe they call them.
Yes, indeed. There'll continue to be that struggle.
Very good. Well, if you're just now tuning in, I have with me from Washington, D.C., Ms. Gwen Kreider, who's executive director of the National Multicultural Institute, and she's my guest. And I guess we're just sort of setting the stage for some more further substantive conversation around their work. I'm privileged to have her with me, and we're going to pause for words from our sponsors. Stay tuned. We'll be back at The World Apart. Don't turn that dial.
Support for Worlds Apart is provided in part by York Foundation, a community foundation, and Susquehanna Falscraft Company.
Through the Community Care Fund, United Way supports programs like the American Red Cross CPR training that saved Vilma Thompson's life.
I just say what a wonderful thing it is to be alive and know that you owe your life to somebody because they took the time to learn how to save a life.
I'd like to thank the community. I'd like to thank everyone that donates to the United Way. And I would like to ask those that don't donate to the United Way to find it in their heart to do so.
Your sweet getaway. Visit HersheyPA.com.
The only reason I chose Central Penn is because it gives you a small individual experience so each and every teacher knows who you are.
The professors know you one-on-one, not by a number, your name.
Not only do we have textbooks to learn from, but we're getting people who are actually in the field.
When they teach you what they have learned, it's actually really good because you know, it's like, wow, this person knows what they're talking about.
I have the drive and the motivation to succeed, and I think the teachers help show me that in myself.
Faculty dedicated to your future success.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by the Bonton.
Welcome back to World Apart. If you're just now tuning in, I'm conducting a two-part series with my guest, Ms. Gwen Kreider, who's the executive director of the National Multicultural Institute. And when we were off camera, I was telling her, I said, I'm like a racism, ethnocentrism parasite as far as trying to compile information. And we were just sharing some things about World Apart, sharing some things with her and vice versa. But I don't make any apologies for it because I think to the extent that the kind of, in my opinion, the substantive kind of conversations that need to be taking place. And not only that conversation, but then the actualization mm-hmm. of the conversations need to take place. Thoughts on that, Ms. Carretta? Mm-hmm.
I think you're right. I think conversation is one thing, and dialogue is very important. Mm-hmm. We do a lot of work around dialogue right. and helping people facilitate those dialogues. Mm-hmm. But if you don't take it from talk to action, mm-hmm. you're missing the final step. Right, you're missing right. the actual change right. that can come out right. of that.
And as you probably well know, and I tell people that I know there are not a lot of programs that systematically or on a weekly basis examine race and how we've evolved mm-hmm. and where we're going. Because I think, you know, when you look at W.E.B. Du Bois mm-hmm. and his, you know, hallmark statement that race still seems, and although he limited to a particular time frame, but it's going beyond that. And we haven't been able to resolve that. And it's in a lot of ways, it's so unfortunate that we still grapple with an issue mm-hmm. like race. And not only is, how should I say, symbolic mm-hmm. issues, but then the way it sort of, again, not sort of, ties into economics and mm-hmm. the ability to have more mobility in terms of choice and change. And the work that you do in some ways tries to bring those bridges in some ways together, or at least mm-hmm. create the structures for people to, I guess, explore further into how do we create more economic opportunities or spread the wealth.
That's right. I mean, part of what we do is try to just get people, A, to stop making assumptions mm-hmm. about others.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
I mean, mm-hmm. that's an important first step mm-hmm. is to say, that's an assumption, it's not necessarily reality, so that you open the door for real understanding between peoples.
Right.
But it really is about building environments where people recognize and really make possible for everyone within that environment to make a full contribution. Mm-hmm. And a person can't do that if they aren't valued, if they aren't acknowledged for who they really are.
Mm, good, good. As we talked about when I came to Washington, the whole issue of diversity training is a multi-billion-dollar industry, mm-hmm. you know, throughout America mm-hmm. and the world. What sets National Multicultural Institute apart?
Mm-hmm. I really think it's our approach to training. Mm-hmm. We do two conferences a year.
Okay.
And at those conferences, we offer 2-day and 4-day workshops.
Okay.
Because when people leave, we want to know that they have real skill that they can go back and apply on the job mm-hmm. as soon as they get there.
Right.
You can't do that in an hour and a half. Right.
Exactly.
Workshop. So mm-hmm. we really take an in-depth approach.
Right.
And then with our private clients who are, again, corporations,
right.
they're nonprofits.
Give some of the names of some of those corporations. I think
yeah.
you have a list of some of your clients.
I do have some of our clients, but right. they've ranged from the IMF, the International Monetary
okay,
Fund.
Okay, Washington, D.C., right, right, right.
We do a lot of work with colleges and universities. We've worked with UConn. We've worked mm-hmm. University of Connecticut.
Mm-hmm.
We've worked with school systems like Arlington Public Schools
okay.
and private schools,
right.
Association of Independent Schools.
Right.
So we work across the board, again, private sector, nonprofit, education. We do a lot of work with government.
Yeah, because IMF, that would take on international implications
correct.
There as far as broader, you know, sort of discussion. So you have to be, I think, very trained in understanding that, and we talked about this,
mm-hmm.
a one-size-fits-all approach is not helpful or
doesn't
beneficial.
Work. Doesn't
Talk
work.
About that. You know,
well,
will.
I think, you know, again, from our perspective, mm-hmm. if we really want to help a company, regardless of the type of company, address their issues and move forward, we have to understand what that company is facing.
Right.
And companies, organizations have cultures of their own.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you're looking to transform that culture so that it becomes more open and more inclusive, we have to understand what's getting in the way of that.
Mm-hmm.
We have to understand what's already working.
Mm-hmm.
What are the strengths that we can build on in doing that?
Mm-hmm.
So we start all of our consulting relationships with that assessment,
mm-hmm.
with talking to people within the company. And we look for and we structure it so that we're talking with people from different backgrounds, both age, gender, race, ethnicity, et cetera,
mm-hmm.
so that we get multiple points of view mm-hmm. that really say, this group is having a very different experience mm-hmm. from this group
mm-hmm.
than this group.
Mm-hmm.
And then we try to pull that all together into a focused action plan.
Mm-hmm.
We end all of our trainings in action planning.
Mm-hmm.
So that when people walk out, they have something that says, here's how I am moving forward
mm-hmm.
based on what I've just learned.
I guess if you looked at sort of the issue of racism as a battlefield, you do sort of strategic kind of triaging because
mm-hmm.
patients come in with specific injuries and all injuries aren't the same.
That's
Some
right.
are more critical than others.
That's
if you
right.
had to assess, I guess, the state of corporate America in terms of where they are in terms of the health of I guess some of the battlefield dynamics mm-hmm. of racism. Would you say they're a serious condition, critical condition, or again, it depends on the client? Or could you just give a general assessment if you had to look at it? I know there's a, I wasn't expecting that kind of a question, but I'm good at analogies.
I think it's a great analogy. Mm-hmm. I think that the challenge for me is the generalization. And I think that, you know, companies still are at all different levels. Mm-hmm. You have some who are still facing crises. Mm-hmm. You know, unfortunately, we haven't moved far enough that we avoid the critical condition mm-hmm. state. You have others who are kind of at that mature stage. Mm-hmm. They have strategies and they have programs that have worked and have worked well.
And let's stop right there. Strategies and programs, mm-hmm. like strategic plans, and they have benchmarks, goals, and assessment mechanism to determine where they are, and they're holding people responsible for
outcomes. That's right. And they have really incorporated it into the entire organizational culture mm-hmm. so that people know when it comes to performance time.
Right.
And we're talking about how have I done. Mm-hmm. That becomes one of the measures against their performance as well.
Okay,
and then you have companies that are out there really looking for, how do we take this to the next level? Mm-hmm. You know, diversity is a fact of life these days. Mm-hmm. Inclusivity is not necessarily that.
Okay, so you would think, wait a minute, diversity and inclusivity, mm-hmm. wouldn't they sort of be corollaries to each other? Or not? They're not exactly the same, but there tend to be some...
They're very different.
Okay.
They're very different. Mm-hmm. I mean, we can't help...
We got
help.
Like 30 seconds, so we might have to come back and respond to that. But we can start it off, Lise, but...
We can't help diversity. Mm-hmm. You know, people are different, period. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean I have to let you into my sandbox.
Okay. Yeah, okay, all right. What we're going to do now on that note is... go through the sandbox of commercials right now. But we're going to pause for words from our sponsors. If you're just now tuning in, I have Ms. Gren Kreider, and she's the Executive Director for the National Multicultural Institute. Stay tuned. We'll be right back to Worlds Apart.
Hershey Foods Corporation supports the efforts of Worlds Apart in promoting the understanding, acceptance, and value of diversity.
Whether it's in the city, the country, or somewhere in between, owning your own home means something special, something comfortable and secure. No wonder it's a dream we all share. We're the Pennsylvania Housing Finance Agency, working to put safe, affordable housing within reach of every citizen. Find out more by visiting phfa.org, because it doesn't have to be just a dream.
When you want words like skilled, expert, and nationally recognized, when you need to have confidence as well as courage, when it's your health, your body, your life, we have the finest team of specialists waiting to help. WellSpan Health, the region's most comprehensive healthcare system. WellSpan Health, for the journey that is life.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by the Bonton Stores Foundation. Worlds Apart is underwritten by Graham Packaging Company. Graham Packaging Company values diversity in the workplace as a competitive advantage.
Hi, I'm Bob Darr, Vice President of Harrisburg Toyota Chrysler Jeep. We're proud to be corporate sponsors of Worlds Apart. And if you're ever in the market for a new Toyota, Chrysler Jeep, or a used car, come on down and see us.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by Wolf Printing.
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. If you're just not tuning in, I have with me Ms. Gren Kreider, who's the Executive Director for the National Multicultural Institute, located in Washington, D.C. And Gwen, if you would, let's talk about the upcoming symposium mm-hmm. or dealing with, I think the title was called Polarization, the Enemy from Within, Collaboration, the Power of Us.
That's correct.
And we'll bring that up on the screen, but talk about that, and mm-hmm. how did you come up with the title?
Mm-hmm. We do, as I mentioned briefly, two big professional development institutes mm-hmm. a year. So this is one of those. And for each of those, we ask ourselves, what's happening out there in the larger world mm-hmm. that we really would like to highlight?
Right.
And at the time we started planning for this event, mm-hmm. which is November 9th through 12th, mm-hmm. there was a lot of polarization, and we really started talking about, you know, we're tearing each other apart.
Why are we worlds apart, huh?
worlds apart, right, absolutely right, right, apropos.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so we decided that with the theme we really wanted to focus on, you know, polarization is within us. Mm-hmm. We're creating that, mm-hmm. and we can keep it going. Mm-hmm. Or we can choose to collaborate and realize really the power that comes through that collaboration and inclusivity.
Right. The dates for that symposium are when?
November 9th through 12th.
9th through 12th.
And starts on a Thursday and right. goes through Sunday.
Now, this program will probably air sometime in early October.
Mm-hmm.
Is there room for late registrations?
There is.
Okay.
There is.
And is there a cost associated for
there is a cost yes. associated with it, depending on whether they're registering for 2 days or for 4 days. Mm-hmm. We do have student rates, and we also have nonprofit rates.
Okay. And
people can go to our website.
Website to look at the prices, or you want to talk about that?
Everything's there on the website.
Okay, on the website, okay.
Because I think I would want people to also really take a look at the stellar caliber of folks who are right. teaching these workshops right. and mm-hmm. the approaches we take.
Okay.
So there's full information on the website. Mm-hmm. They can call our office mm-hmm. If they have questions
would
about
you give
it.
Us that number, and we'll put that up
sure,
on the screen?
Sure, it's 202-483-0700.
Give us a sort of a synopsis of some of the caliber of mm-hmm. guests that you'll be right mm-hmm. there that are going to be presenting, please.
Our keynoter for this particular conference will be Dr. Carmen Tafoya,
okay.
Who is actually a performance artist as well as a poet.
Oh, okay.
Coming out of San Antonio.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And she will be doing a one-woman show
oh, okay.
to introduce our conference and representing different cultures, different voices.
Okay.
So she's setting the tone at the outset. Mm-hmm. We have Dolores Fridge, who is with Medtronic Corporation in her real life job.
Okay.
And Manny Brandt, who do a workshop on designing diversity initiatives.
Right.
We have, oh God, I can't even think of all the names right now, but we have about 22 or 24 workshop instructors drawn from all around the country right. from different aspects of experience.
Right, so they'll basically address probably any issue that any kind of corporate entity would
That's
either
right.
want to know more about or sort of say or gain some further insight on how they can sort of change their institutions.
That's right, and our workshops are structured so we have some training of trainers.
Mm-hmm.
If someone wants to do training within their organization mm-hmm. around diversity mm-hmm. issues, I mentioned we have a workshop, a four-day workshop on how do you design a whole diversity
right,
initiative,
right. That's
which would also pick up on the measurement question.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, right.
We have a separate workshop on measurement.
Mm-hmm.
We have
as far as measuring outcomes. How well we address yep. these issues. That's important in my opinion.
Yeah. How do you know that this is having an impact right. on the bottom line?
And do we need to maybe then readjust what we had set out maybe
That's
in
right.
our strategic plan or whatever?
That's right.
And come up with a different benchmark.
A different benchmark.
Right. Okay.
I mentioned we do a lot of work with schools, so we have a workshop for educators looking at how to design a more multicultural and inclusive environment within
schools.
Because
I'm an educational consultant for a school district right now, and we're working on the black-white achievement gap.
Uh-huh.
And some of the issues, and
Which
one of the
is
issues
huge.
Is cultural competency for educators.
Absolutely.
And I know that school district or school districts that are similarly sort of situated that are affluent and in, primarily white suburban school districts, the ethnic demographics are shifting.
Yes.
I know some school districts, the minority populations are closer to 50%
That's
now,
right.
and people are trying to make some adjustments. Some are doing better than others, as you said, as
yeah.
far as a corporate model, so
yeah.
I understand that clearly. Yeah. And so you also have manuals that mm-hmm. people can purchase. You want to talk about some mm-hmm. of the manuals?
We have a number of publications
okay.
Through NMCI, and
okay.
three or four of them are specifically training manuals.
Mm-hmm.
We have one called Developing Diversity Training for the Workplace,
mm-hmm.
Which again is a basic, how do you manage a diverse workshop? How do you really design a program to teach diversity to others within your workforce?
Right.
We do a lot of work in healthcare, so we have a manual called Cultural Competency in Healthcare.
Right. I went out to Stanford and did a two-part series where we looked at cultural competency in healthcare.
I mean, this is an incredible resource
mm-hmm.
because, again, it gives people both mini lectures, it gives them other tools, it gives them case studies they can use mm-hmm. to help others understand why cultural competency is so important in healthcare.
Give us a brief, if you give a brief definition, what is cultural competency? And I know it may be specific, more specific to different institutions. Give us a general definition.
Cultural competency, elevator speech, is recognizing that we all have differences and we all have differences that contribute positively to what we're trying to do. Right. And it's being open and aware and understanding of those differences. Mm-hmm.
Okay, very good. And here's another
one. We also have one
called, this is what I'm more interested in right here. I'm going to get a copy of that one.
Teaching skills and cultural competency. Right. Again, looking at if I'm a teacher, how do I really promote and build cultural competency among my students and in my school.
Okay, very good. Well, we're going to continue our conversation in part two in our series where we'll look more substantively in terms of what your organization is doing. And again, I'm thankful for having you come up from Washington, D.C. I appreciate that because I just think it's important that there are groups that are looking to try to address this issue. And this program has been a clearinghouse to look at the issue of race and ethnocentrism from various panoramic institutional perspectives. I think it's important because I know there are not many programs out in the United States that are looking at that. So thank you for coming, and we're going to have you back next week for part two in our series. Again, you've been listening to World and watching Worlds Apart. I'm your host, Brian Wade. We're in our 10th year now, and we're glad to have people like Glenn Pratt in the program. So for Worlds Apart, I'm Brian Wade. Good evening, good night, and God bless.
The African American History Minute. Today's trivia question is, who was the founder of the Universal Negro Improvement League? Today's featured African American is Dorothy Height. It is said of Dorothy Height, her lifetime of achievement measures the liberation of Black America, the advancement of women's rights, and a determined effort to lift the poor and the powerless. Height began her career as a staff member of the YWCA in New York City, becoming director of the Center for Racial Justice. She became a volunteer with the National Council of Negro Women when she worked with the NCNW founder, Mary McLeod Bethune. When Bethune died, Height became president, a position she continues to hold. Now, back to our trivia question. Who was the founder of the Universal Negro Improvement League? The answer is Marcus Garvey. For more information about Marcus Garvey and Dorothy Height, visit theminute.org. Until next time, remember, we're standing on the shoulders of giants.